A big hello to all our viewers on this live broadcast session by Voice of Healthcare. This is Dr. Naveen Nischal. I am your host of the day. Today, we are fortunate enough to have with us Mr. Rajiv Arora, Additional Chief Secretary, Government of Haryana, and he heads Department of Health and Family Welfare. Sir, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this very special episode of Thought Leadership hosted by VUH Network. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much for having me here.
Thank you. So our big goal today is to gather unique knowledge, insights, and inspiration from a leading and dynamic mind such as yours. I think nothing unites better than the power of shared experiences. And my philosophy is the more we spread our ideas, the stronger our community becomes. Sir, for this session, we will be having a free-flowing chat. So let's dive straight into the conversation.
Yeah.
Sir, as you know that we are, you know, going through an unprecedented time, this is tough time. And Haryana being, closure to Delhi, Haryana shares a border with Delhi also. Although comparison is not right comparison, Haryana is much more popular than Delhi. And Delhi has, you know, is more dense in terms of population. And Delhi has more than 6.5 lakh cases, and Haryana has only 2.5 lakh cases. So can we say that we are tackling COVID-19 in Haryana better? So what has been your experience and how you are tackling this disease in this tough time? So would like to hear from you.
Yeah, you see, as far as I'm concerned, I'll not like to kind of make comparisons with any other state, but I like to say that standalone, we have done tremendous amount of effort in Haryana right from the very beginning. I still remember that in the month of March, when the COVID started coming to our country, now that was the time when whenever we had to take a sample, and we used to take the sample right to the National Institute of Virology in Pune by the couriers, and then used to get the report in 2-3 days' time. The second phase was that we used to started doing the testing in Haryana itself in one lab. And then if it was positive, then for confirmation of that positive case, we used to go to the NIV Pune. So today, suffice it to say that today I'm doing 35,000 samples every day in Haryana. So today in about, say about 7 to 8 months time, we have created the infrastructure both in the public sector and in the private sector that we are able to get about 35,000 samples tested every day with the testing results being coming less than 24 hours. The rates, you see, the first time the Government of India fixed rates for the private labs for RT-PCR, it was 4,500 rupees official rate. Today, our official rate is 700 rupees. So that is how the progress has moved. And there was a day, in fact, not too long ago, when on one day, on a sample testing day, it was a kind of observed as a sample testing day, we tested more than 1,25,000 samples. So that is the kind of ramping up which we had to do. We have been right from the beginning been very clear on one thing, that please don't, we don't want to, I told all my teams that we don't have to hide the figures. We have to chase the virus, and we have to see that wherever people are infected by amount of sampling, by volume of sampling, we have to pick them up, and then we have to isolate them so that the transmission chain can be broken. And that is why we have not been very concerned about what numbers are coming. It's good that we have about 2,55,000 people who came positive in all these things. But the main thing is that our fatality rate is less than 1.1. It is 1.08, in fact, as of now. So that I consider as a much better achievement, because out of 2,55,000 people who have tested positive, there are just about 2,765 number of people who unfortunately died. And even out of those 2,765, there were just about 349 people who were without comorbidities. Rest all of them had some comorbidity or the other. So ours, I think our entire effort has been that try and see and isolate the person with the symptoms and with the disease or the infection right at the beginning, isolate them, give them the treatment, and see to it that whenever they need hospitalization, we have the hospital infrastructure, the isolation beds, the ICU beds, the ventilators, all available. In fact, we have a total of about 60,000 beds, out of which more than 45,000 are the isolation beds. More than 11,000 are the beds which are having the oxygen also with them. And we have more than about 1,700 ventilators with us. So the thrust has always been that try and isolate the people with infection, break the chain of transmission by more and more use of technology, use the contact tracing, use the other methods and see that how we can kind of isolate them and treat them so that our mortality is low and the overall collective damage on the population is the lowest.
So yeah, I agree with you that, you know, isolation, contact tracing and timely treatment, so these are the important aspects of COVID-19 treatment. And I you know, it's a commendable job has been done under your leadership in Haryana, and I really appreciate the kind of effort and hard work has been put in by yourself and your team. So it's a great effort for the state. So while talking about, you know, COVID-19 preparedness, treatment, isolation, and now although vaccine is we are talking about it for quite some time, and that I think that time has arrived when, you know, companies like Pfizer, AstraZeneca and Moderna, so these companies are already in the market, and Pfizer has already been approved by a couple of countries like USA, UK, Singapore, and in India also companies like Pfizer and Bharat Biotech, they have also put in application for emergency approval to DGCI. And I'm sure in a week or two, they will get approval, I mean, basis on their, you know, performance and all. And recently, you know, our Prime Minister also took the stock of things in terms of preparedness. So I was curious and I wanted to know, where do we stand in terms of logistics, cold chain preparedness while it comes to vaccination? And what do you think when it is going to, because you are part of the government and you know better when it is going to when we are, you know, going to begin with the vaccination process. So I would like to hear from you, where do we stand in terms of all this preparedness?
Yeah, before I come to answer your question on the vaccination part, I would like to say that prior to COVID, of course, during certain sporadic campaigns like the Pulse Polio campaign and such other campaigns, the entire district and the state administration used to be involved in administering and managing the campaigns. But that used to be always on, say, 2-day or 3-day basis. But COVID has altered the administration also in a fundamental way, that health has become a kind of center spread in everybody's priority. And what we find is that right from the first administrator in the state, say the chief minister, the health minister, all the senior officers, all the district officers, the deputy commissioners, the police officers, the other people, so all of them have worked like teams. And you see, this is the experience which everybody has experienced during the last 7-8 months of working as teams right from the village level, block level, district level and state level, that is going to come in handy for the vaccine program also. We are fortunate in Haryana in one sense that we already have a UNDP based EVEN project, which is Electronic Vaccine Intelligence Network project, and we have a well established cold chain which is already there, starting from a state warehouse to the regional warehouses to the district warehouses to the cold chain points and the mobile vans also which are available. From our side, as of now, the entire preparation is a kind of top-down preparation, that the entire roadmap has already been drawn by Government of India and we are following it. We have formed the block level committees, the district level committees, the state task force and the steering committee at the state level under the chief secretary. All the meetings are taking place and every week, once or twice, we review the preparation which is there. So as it has also been said that the vaccination program for the COVID is going to be implemented on a same scale as if the election program is going to be always gets implemented. So there are going to have, just as you have the polling parties, so here you'll have the vaccination parties consisting of 5 people, including a vaccinator, people to have the security, and other persons, about 5 people who are going to be part of that vaccination party. And they are the ones who are going to administer it. So every logistic is being tied up, has been tied up. And now we are kind of all waiting for the approvals which are given by the Government of India, and then the actual supply of vaccine which starts. Government of India has already drawn a priority list of people who have to be given on priority. The first one is, of course, the frontline health workers. The second one is the frontline workers of other departments. Then you have people who are above 50, and then you have people who are below 50 also in the comorbidity. And we have also sent our suggestions to Government of India. There is a committee in Government of India called NECVEC, which takes care of all these suggestions. And we have also said that what all people need to be included in the second line of frontline workers, and how we have also suggested that since Haryana has conducted 2 sero surveys and many other states have also conducted, so what about the people who have already developed antibodies with them? Are they to be covered in the vaccination program, or they're not to be covered? But I think that would be a little far from today. First of all, the immediate priority is to vaccinate the people who are the frontline health workers, and we are quite ready with it. We have about 2 lakh health workers who come in this category, including all of the public sector as well as the private sector health infrastructure also. So all those workers, they have already been put in the database which has been created by Government of India, and all informations have been conveyed, and we are ready to launch it at an hour's notice whenever the supplies come and the program rolls off.
Got it. So I think this is the first time when entire state machinery is working towards, you know, for the health of its people. You know, earlier I'm in healthcare industry for quite some time. I'm a doctor by training, and this is the first time I have seen that everybody is working for health, which is I think unprecedented in terms of, you know, if we compare it with past. So while talking about, you know, vaccination, who to be vaccinated and who is not to be vaccinated, a couple of friends in the States, in USA, they told me that in USA what they are doing, if you are documented positive in last 3 months, you don't need any vaccination. And everybody else, even if they are positive in sero survey, they are also getting vaccinated. But maybe Indian policy be different. So I think we'll get to know with time. So while we are talking about COVID-19 all the time for last almost 1 year, and there are a lot of other things in healthcare which are on the back burner for quite some time. And recently, Government of India came up with National Health Digital Mission, and they are going to launch it in Union Territories. So I just wanted to know where do we stand in terms of implementing NHDM in Haryana, because technology has a huge potential, and it can help in accessibility, affordability, and quality of healthcare. So what are your views in digital healthcare?
You see, the question is that there are 2-3 things I'll like to talk before I come to the digital health. The first and foremost is that the kind of mobilization of the state administration which has taken place, I personally am of the opinion that once the COVID is finished, then probably all of us should put our heads together and in the next 2-3 years' time, see to it that very intensive campaigns on the pattern of COVID are also carried out for the elimination of the TB, for the elimination of the jaundice and other such programs, hepatitis and all, because this is the time when entire district state administration is highly mobilized and highly motivated. So if you see the effort which has been put in terms of COVID, I think the effort which is required in terms of elimination of TB or substantial reduction in those numbers or in the hepatitis is far less required than what it has been done in COVID. So we must utilize this heightened mobilization to give a tremendous boost to the other programs also. Now, when it comes to the digital health mission of Government of India, this is a very, very welcome step which the Government of India has taken. The only thing I'd like to say is that at our level, we have already been kind of variously utilizing the information technology in terms of patients, in terms of our systems, in terms of the medical system. What Government of India project will do is that as of now, all these states are having their own kind of localized digitization, which is there, and in localized areas where the digitization is there. So now we'll try and achieve that there is a kind of more uniformity and there is a kind of more transferability of this entire thing all over the country. So that is, I think, going to be a major benefit of the Digital Health Mission program. In Haryana, we already have an e-Upchar program where a number of hospitals, they have already been put up on e-Upchar, where the patients, when they go from that time onwards, everything is digitized. But what we require is that this particular program, which is there, that we should be able to do in a much more comprehensive manner. So just as in the case of Ayushman Bharat, Government of India has created a full platform through the National Health Agency. Incidentally, this National Digital Health Mission is also, the platform is being created by the National Health Agency only. So I'm sure that it is going to be extremely important and extremely useful to integrate all the different efforts which are being going on at the state level, integrate them in a manner that there can be a tremendous impact on the overall system rather than anything else. So we are fully geared for it. Government of India has also launched a lot of initiatives about e-Sanjeevani program, telemedicine program. They're all part of the digital health mission also. Electronic data records of the patient. So all those things, I'm sure once the digital health program is rolled out, it will give tremendous boost to the entire database pertaining to the health of the people. And just as in other fields, the use of information technology has given a lot of impetus to better efficiencies and better utilization of resources, I'm sure this will also help in that.
Thank you. So while talking about technology, I can't miss out all my friends who are working in health tech field. I mean, there are a lot of healthcare startups who are, you know, marrying technology with healthcare and coming up with very good solutions. So I wanted to know that how you are promoting these healthcare startups in Haryana and what are your plans in terms of investment? Because as a state, we need more and more investment in different startups. So I want to know, where do we stand in terms of healthcare startups and investment?
You see, as far as investment is concerned, investment can be in the physical infrastructure by creation of better facilities for the treatment of people. And it can also be in the kind of services sector where the startups are working in a way where they are making things much more easier for the people, whether it is through e-pharmacy or it is through getting consultations online or it is getting through participating in the programs like e-Upchar, what we already have. So we have, Gurgaon is one of the areas which is kind of well developed as a startup hub also. And I'm sure that once the digital health mission program is rolled out, then it is quite possible that to achieve the various ends, we might have to engage with a lot of them to see that the objectives of this program are achieved to the large extent.
So I'll ask some different question now. So you have been into this service for quite some time, and you have got through different departments, different portfolios. So how do you rate your experience with healthcare and other departments? And is there any learning? Is there any learning which healthcare can take from other sectors here?
You see, one thing is there that I think the amount of satisfaction which you get while working in health sector is not the same which you get in many other sectors. And secondly, I would say is that the health sector also has to do a lot of learning, because as of now, the health departments and the health infrastructure in most of the states is still organized mostly about the governmentalized systems which are there. But I think in the last 3, 4, 5 years, the NHM scope has increased to a great extent. Government has given a lot of emphasis on AYUSH, the alternate systems of medicine. Yeah. That's another thing which has come into the Indian medical system. Thirdly, I also find that there is a lot of now involvement of the hospitals in starting the DNB programs and the diploma programs for those graduates from the medical colleges who are not able to get regular admission in the MDs and the diploma program. So which means we are trying to kind of leverage the infrastructure which is there for also creating academic opportunities for the students for doing their DNB programs and their diploma programs. That again is a big plus. The Ayushman Bharat program, which has come, ultimately is going to revolutionize in days to come the entire healthcare infrastructure in the country. Because not only, in fact, today, if you find that as government servant and there is a normal citizen who's covered in the Ayushman Bharat program, the efficiency of the Ayushman Bharat program is far better than what the reimbursement model of the state government is. In fact, today only we had a meeting under the Honorable Chief Minister where we planned to do the entire employees and serving as well as the retired employees reimbursement model, shifted to a cashless model based on the Ayushman Bharat, so that you can. So all these are the things which are. So I would say that in the last few years, technology is penetrating the health department. IT is penetrating the health department in a big way. A lot of people are getting into creation of physical infrastructure in the state. So I'm sure that if things go like this, in the next 3, 4, 5 years time, we will have a tremendous focus which is coming on the health sector, and that should ultimately translate into better health for the people.
Yeah, I fully agree with you that Ayushman Bharat is the world's largest scheme, and it is impacting in a big way. And 40% of Indian population is covered under this scheme. I think this is a big step towards affordability. Although accessibility still remains a challenge, because most of the healthcare services are still concentrated in bigger cities or tier 2 cities. When it comes to rural India, we are still lagging in terms of healthcare services. And you know that there are more than 2.5 lakh villages in India. And I don't think that every village has a primary health center or every village has a MBBS doctor working there. But I think with Ayushman Bharat, with technology, we will definitely solve all these issues. And together, I mean, we have to work together and we have to come up with more and more such programs. PPP is another program which is really a good program. Because you know that government is only providing 20% of the services in terms of healthcare delivery, where private sector is providing most of the services. So PPP is another thing which can help in a big way. So I will not take much of your time before we leave this session. I would ask you, or I would, you know, request you for our viewers and all the doctors, paramedical staff, frontliners who are working in this tough time. So if you can, you know, say some motivational word for them, that would be really great.
Yeah. So you just talked about PPP program. I'd like to say that in our government hospitals, we have tried to convert them from secondary care to, in many areas, tertiary care. We have established a lot of places where we can go in for cardiac interventions. We can go for MRI, for dialysis, for all those things. And in all those areas, what we have done is that we have outsourced those services to the PPP partners. So we are providing the premises, we are providing the patients, and the entire facility is being created by the PPP partner with the prior fixed rates. So PPP has given a lot of, I would say, tremendous fillip to the creation of tertiary facilities, even in the government hospitals, which are known only as a secondary level. Now, when you could talk about saying something to the health workers and the doctors and others in a motivational way, I would say that probably we have been kind of motivated a great deal from them in the last 6-7 months. We have learned that the grit and determination with which the health and health personnel, whether in the paramedical or in the medical or in the non-medical category, the way they have moved, I think that has created a kind of motivation for everybody who's there. So I would say that it is the reverse thing, that in the last 6-8 months, we have been motivated by the motivational level of the people who have been working in the field. And I salute all of them all over the country, wherever they are, that the kind of efforts they have put in, the kind of selfless efforts they have put in, and that too at a time when people were not even prepared to listen to what COVID is, and people used to kind of leave their relatives and everybody wherever they were. There was so much of fear which was there. These people have provided a kind of beacon of light, and they have fought COVID like anything. So my salute to them, my salutations to them, and I am sure that with their efforts, our health system in the country is in very, very safe hand. I would also say that I should not be saying it, but in the first 2-4 months, it was primarily the government health system which took up the challenge. Because that was the time when there was so much of scare, the others were not, it was the government health system, or probably the bigger corporate hospitals which has the wherewithal. But the intermediate level private health infrastructure had almost kind of shut down, because people were also not going, and on the side, they had also not developed the protocols. So I would also like to specifically take this opportunity to salute all those people who worked in the government public health care system. I'm sure that with them, the health system is in safe hands, and we'll see tremendous strides. I'm very, very optimistic that in the next 5 to 6 years, this is going to be the biggest area in India in terms of employment and in terms of the returns also which gives to the population, because a healthy population is the one which can have a better productivity, better life, everything in a better way. Thank you very much. I think it was very nice talking to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I wish we could go on with this really engaging session, but unfortunately, that's all the time we have today. Thank you so much for inspiring session, sir. I'm sure the points we touched upon today will provide positive thinking and trigger timely interventions within the healthcare community in India and around the world. I'm grateful to you for sharing your precious time and esteemed opinion with us. We hope to have you again with us, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.